Subject is web-based system designs and the subject code is CA588. Now today in this particular subject we will study the introduction to internet. Now what is internet? It is a network of networks that consists of millions of private, public, academic, business and government networks of local to global scope that are linked by a broad array of electronic, wireless and optical networking technologies. Now there are different organizations that are working for this internet. Some of them are IETF, IRTF, IAB, W3C, IESG, ISOC. Now we will discuss some of them one by one. Now first one is IETF. IETF is Internet Engineering Task Force. It develops and promotes internet standards. The goal of IETF is to make the internet work better by producing high quality, relevant technical documents that influence the way people design, use and manage the internet. Now it is dealing in particular with the standards of the internet protocol suite, that is TCP/IP. It focuses on shorter term issues of engineering and standard making. Now the next organization that is working for internet is IRTF, that is Internet Research Task Force. It focuses on longer term research issues related to internet. It promotes research of importance to the evolution of the internet by creating focused long term research groups working on topics related to internet protocols, applications, its architecture and technology. IAB is Internet Architecture Board. It oversees the IETF and IRTF organizations. The IAB supervises the IETF, which oversees the evolution of TCP/IP, and IRTF, which works on network technologies like governance, risk management, mobile application management, 2G, 3G, etc. That is the W3C, that is World Wide Web Consortium, that is very important. It is the main international standard organization for World Wide Web developed by Tim Berners-Lee. Its mission is to lead the World Wide Web to its full potential by developing protocols and guidelines that ensure the long-term growth of the web. The main goal of W3C is to enable human communication, commerce and opportunities to share knowledge amongst all the people with different hardware, software, network, infrastructure, native languages, culture, geographical locations, etc. Now the services provided by the internet. There are different services that are provided by internet. We will discuss some of them. First one is electronic mail. That is very important for all of us. It is the method of exchanging digital messages from an author to one or more recipients. Now it works on store and forward model. Email server accepts forward, deliver and store messages. Neither the computer of the sender nor the computer of the receiver are required to be online simultaneously. If sender is sending a message and the client is not online at that time, then that message will be stored for the later use. When the client will come online, then he or she can see the message that is stored on his mailbox. Now, the example of email service providers are Gmail, Hotmail, Yahoo, etc. World Wide Web, that is another service that is provided by internet. It is the most important service provided by the internet. It is an internet-based hypermedia initiative for global information sharing developed by Tim Berners-Lee. It is used for searching information on the internet. Examples of this is Google, Yahoo, Wikipedia, etc. Now, next service that is provided by internet is FTP, that is File Transfer Protocol. It is a standard network protocol used to transfer files from one host to another host over a TCP based network such as the internet. So it is built on a client server architecture and uses separate control and data connection between client and the server. Check chat rooms. That is another service. We usually use these chat rooms for our chatting purpose. Now it is the real-time typed conversation using computers. Chat rooms are the channel or the medium, and the chat clients are the programs used to connect to a chat server. These are normally included in the browser or can be freely downloaded from the web. Some are textually and the other supports voice and video. So we can share the video and audio files on these chat rooms. Mailing list. Then group of email addresses given a single name, that is known as mailing list. When a message is sent to a mailing list, everyone on the list will receive the message. Now to add your name to the mailing list, you must subscribe to it. So that is the condition for be a part of the mailing list. Next is instant messaging. Instant messaging, it notifies you when one or more people are online. It allows exchange of messages and files and also allows you to join a private chat group. Another service that is provided by internet is news groups. Now this is the online area in which users conduct written discussion about a particular subject. Usenet is the collection of all internet news groups. News server stores the news group messages, and the news reader is a program used to access news groups. A previously added message is known as an article. So anybody can write the article and anybody can read that article that is a part of that news group. Adding an article to the news group is known as posting. News blog is a regularly updated web blog. Now the impact of internet on society. The internet has a very drastic impact on the society. So first impact is easy communication. Now we can share our information on the internet very easily. That is, it is saving our time, and we can communicate with our friends or family that are abroad or somewhere in the at other location. Now e-business. Second, that the impact is e-business. There are so many websites through which we can buy online things, whether they are related to house or they are related to books. So like Alibaba.in, Amazon.in. So these are the few websites that are working for the commercial websites. Now e-governance. As the government has given us some opportunities to have the view of what the government is doing. So e-governance is one thing. Like government has given some applications, online applications through which we can like income tax, we can pay our income tax online, we can book the tickets, railway tickets online. So these are the few facilities that are provided by the government. E-learning. Now anything that you want that comes in your mind, you can search on the internet. So it learning has become easy with the help of the internet. Now there is another impact on the society, that most of the people are working from home. With the availability of internet, we can connect to clients anywhere in the world at any time from home itself. So that is another impact on society. Next one is freedom of speech. Freedom of speech means we can write anything, our feelings on the internet. So we can express our feelings on the internet, and that is another impact on the society. Next, last one is crime on internet. As internet has provided us with a few facilities, but the crime on internet has been increased. As you already know that hacking is possible, so hackers are hacking your accounts or your passwords, and they are sending the messages to your near ones, bad messages to the near ones. So the crime has increased. So that is a bad impact of internet on the society. Now what is World Wide Web? This web is a network of computers all over the world. All the computers in the web communicate with each other through a common protocol, HTTP. The web information is stored in documents called web pages, and the web pages are files stored on computers called web servers. Now the computers reading the web pages are called web clients. So web clients view the pages with a program called web browser, like Internet Explorer, Google Chrome, etc. Now what is a web server? The collection of all the web pages is called a website. To let others view your website, you must publish your website. To publish a website, a computer that is connecting to the internet and can act as a web server is required. So the server software includes configuration files and utilities to secure and manage the website in a variety of ways. A web server passes requests to run CJ scripts to the CGI applications. These scripts run external mini programs such as database lookup or interactive form processing. Now, types of expenses for hosting a website. There are different expenses: hardware expenses, software expenses, and labor expenses. Now, the hardware expenses, in case of hardware expenses, the permanent high speed internet connection with powerful server hardware is required. So, that is your hardware expenses. In software expenses, the cost of server licenses is higher than the client licenses, and there is a limit on number of users for a server license. So that comes under software licensing. Then last one is labor expenses. Labor expenses means when we want to host our website of our own, then software and hardware installations, handling of bugs and viruses need more labor, and the server has to be constantly running in an environment where everything could happen. So therefore manpower is required. So that comes under labor expenses. Now, what is internet service provider? An ISP is ISP provides internet services like web hosting. Web hosting includes services like email services, domain name registration, etc., which are provided by an ISP. Advantages of using an ISP for hosting a website. So, if we are hosting our website through an ISP, so it has the advantages like connection speed. Connection speed provided by an ISP is very high, and ISP provides a powerful hardware, because ISP have powerful web servers that can be shared by several companies with effective load balancing and necessary backup facility. The next advantage of hosting a website from an ISP is security and stability. ISPs are the specialists in web hosting. They have latest software patches, best virus protection with 99% uptime. So these are the few advantages of hosting a website through an ISP. Now, what are the different points that we have to consider while choosing an ISP? Because there are number of companies that are providing these internet services. So we have to keep the following points in mind. That is, it should provide 24-hour support, daily backup of your website, traffic volume, there should not be any restriction on the traffic volume, and do not have to pay extra when the traffic volume increases in case of your website. The bandwidth or the content restriction should not be there, so it should have the high bandwidth. Next is email capability. So the ISP that will provide you the complete email capabilities, you have to choose that ISP. And the last one is database access. Database access, there should not be any restriction on database support. So that you have to keep in mind. Now, what is a domain name? It is a unique name for a website. A domain name should be registered and stored on DNS server. A domain name registration company's interface to search for available domain names. So DNS server is responsible for informing all other computers on the internet about the domain name and the website address. Domain name should be short, meaningful, and clear, so that your site should have a maximum exposure on the search engines. Now, what is a URL? That is a uniform resource locator. A URL is a formatted string used by web browser, email clients, and other softwares to identify a network resource on the internet. Network resources are the files that can be the plain web pages, text documents, or program. Now, the URL string consists of the three parts. First one is the network protocol, second one is the host name, and third one is the file name. For example, in this case, HTTP is the network protocol that has been used. spsu.ac.in is the host name, and index.html is the HTML is the file name that we want to access. Now, types of web hosting. There are four types of web hosting. First one is free hosting, shared or virtual hosting, dedicated hosting, and co-located hosting. So we will discuss these types of hosting one by one. First one is free hosting. Now, some ISPs offer free web hosting. It is suitable for small sites with low traffic like personal sites. Technical support is often limited and have to use a domain name provided by the host. For example, this is the domain name that is provided. This is the web page that has been provided to you. Now, the advantages of hosting a free website is, as it is free, that is the advantage. Now, it is good for family, hobby or personal sites. Now, there are disadvantages of this free hosting, as there is no independent domain name that will be provided to you by the ISP. Few limited or no software options that will be available for you, and the limited security options, database support and technical support. So these are the disadvantages of hosting a website for free. Second one is shared or virtual hosting. Now, it is a cost effective solution, and the website gets the own domain name and is hosted on a powerful web server with other sites. Now, the ISP will have a web server, powerful web server, and it will host a number of websites from that web server, and the cost will be shared by all the companies that are hosting, that wants to host their website from that web server. Now, there are advantages, as it is less costly, as web server is shared with other websites. It is good for small business and average traffic. Multiple software options with good technical support is provided, and it has own domain name, but still it has some disadvantages, like it is less secure as other sites are running along with yours. Restricted database support is there, and there is a restriction on traffic volume. Third type of web hosting is dedicated hosting. Now, in this case, website is hosted on a dedicated web server. So, ISP will provide you with the web server. On that web server, your site will be hosted. No other company is allowed to use that web server for hosting its website. So, there are advantages and there are few disadvantages also. The advantages are, it is good for large business having high traffic, and it provides multiple domain names, provides powerful database support with unlimited software support. So, it has many advantages. And disadvantage is, it is most expensive, because you have to bear the cost of that web server, and it requires higher skills to maintain that site. Now, next one is co-located hosting. Co-location means co-location, that is, this type of web hosting provides the facility to place your own web server on the location of the internet service. See, what is the difference between the dedicated hosting and co-located hosting is, in case of dedicated hosting, the web server will be provided by the ISP, right? And that will be placed at the location of the ISP. But in case of co-located hosting, you are going to provide the web server to the ISP, and that will be placed at the location of the ISP. So that is the difference between the co-located and the dedicated hosting. Now, there are advantages of this co-located hosting. It will provide you with the high bandwidth, high uptime, high security, and with unlimited software options. But still, it has disadvantages, like it is expensive, it requires higher skills, and it is harder to configure and debug. So these are the types of web hosting. Now we will discuss about the internet protocols that are required for transferring the information from source to destination. Now first we will discuss what is a protocol and what are the different protocol suites. Now, what is a protocol? Protocol are the rules for determining the format and transmission of data on the internet. Network provides computers with the basic ability of transferring bits to another computer. A set of rules is required to use the computer, use the network, which all the other members of a network agree upon. So, this is called a protocol. Now, what is a protocol suite? To simplify the design and implementation of protocols, a set of protocols has been designed so that each one has different responsibilities. instead of a single protocol being responsible for handling all forms of communication. Now the set of such protocols is called a protocol suite, which covers all forms of communication needs. Now we will discuss few of the internet protocols like TCP/IP, FTP, HTTP, Telnet, Gopher and WAIS. Now first protocol that we will discuss is TCP/IP. TCP is Transmission Control Protocol and IP is Internet Working Protocol. Now TCP/IP is a collection of protocols for communication between computers on the internet. TCP breaks the data into packets that a network can handle efficiently at the source computer. Now the IP envelopes and addresses the data with the destination address so that the network can read the address and forward it to the destination. Now TCP reassembles the data at the destination site and verifies whether all the packets have arrived at the destination or not. Now the members of a TCP/IP protocol suite are as follows. So we will discuss the TCP/IP members. First one is ARP. ARP is Address Resolution Protocol. Now it relates IP address with the hardware address. So this is the function of ARP. Then comes BGP or EGP. BGP is Border Gateway Protocol and EGP is Exterior Gateway Protocol. Now these protocols handles the way data is passed between the networks. That is the function of these two. Now next member is ICMP. ICMP is Internet Control Message Protocol. It handles errors and sends error messages for TCP/IP. Next member is OSPF. OSPF is Open Shortest Path First. So it is a descendant of RIP that increases speed and reliability. Then comes PPP. PPP, that is Point to Point Protocol. It is a communication protocol used over serial lines to support internet connectivity. Next one is POP3, IMAP4. Now POP3 is Post Office Protocol version 3 and IMAP is Internet Message Advertising Protocol version 4. So both these protocols set up ways for clients to connect to the servers and collect email. Next one is RIP. RIP is Routing Information Protocol. It finds quickest path route between two computers. Next is SMTP. SMTP is Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. It finds out how email is passed between servers on TCP/IP network. Then the last one is SNMP. SNMP is Simple Network Management Protocol. This protocol allows network administrators to connect to and manage network devices. So we can see the architecture of TCP/IP. As you can see, this is the OSI model layer and these are different layers that are available in OSI model. Now in case of TCP/IP protocol architecture layer, we have application layer, host to host transport layer, internet layer and network interface layer. Now in case of TCP/IP, because it is a protocol suite, these are the different members that are protocol members that are available in that TCP/IP protocol suite at different layers. So in application layer we have these protocols, at the transport layer we have TCP and UDP protocols, and internet layer we have ARP, IP is the main part, IGMP and ICMP, and at the network layer we have Ethernet, Token Frame Relay and AP. So this is the architecture of TCP/IP protocol. Now next protocol is FTP, that is File Transfer Protocol. So it is a part of TCP/IP protocol suite. It enables files to be transferred between computers. FTP works on the client server principle. A client program enables the user to interact with the server in order to access information and the services on the server computer. Files that can be transferred are stored on computers called FTP servers. The files that are publicly available are shareware. Shareware means the softwares that are free for a trial period. Then we have to buy a license for that. Freeware is the software that are completely free, like fonts, clip arts, games, etc. Upgrades for the existing softwares, like mostly we have the Windows upgrade when we are switching on the our system. Patches are the fixes that are used for fixing the software problems. documents like research papers, articles that are available on the internet. So this is the working model of FTP. This is a PI server and this is a DTP server. PI is protocol interpreter and DTP is data transfer protocol process. So and this is the client side, and it is having the graphical user interface that is provided to the user. Then we have the PI client and DTP user. Now the response is going from PI client to the PI server, and the commands are coming. And then this is the data channel through which the DTP user is accessing the DTP server. Next one is HTTP, that is Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Now it is a set of rules that governs the transfer of hypertext between two or more computers. Hypertext is a text that is specially coded using a standard system called HTML. HTTP is based on client-server principle. It allows one computer to establish a connection with another computer like this and makes a request. So this is the client and this is the server, HTTP server. HTTP requests go from this client to the HTTP server. Now the server accepts the connection initiated by the client and sends back the response in the form of HTTP response. So an HTTP request identifies the resource that the client is interested in and tells the server what action is to be taken on the resource. So this is the HTTP protocol. Now next one is Telnet. Now it enables one computer to connect to another computer. This process is also referred to as remote login. The user's computer which has initiated the connection is referred to as a local computer, and the computer which accepts the request is referred to as the remote computer. So we can say this is a Telnet client and this is a Telnet server. So the commands typed on the local computer are executed on the remote server, and the user's computer displays what is taking place on the remote computer during the Telnet session. So request is going and that will be executed on the server, and the input from the client keyboard, output from the server to the client will be displayed on the client machine. Then is a Gopher. Gopher 8 is a protocol designed to search, retrieve and display documents from remote sites on the internet. In addition to document display, document retrieval, it is possible to initiate online connection with other systems via Gopher. So this can be accomplished by a client-server model. Information accessible through Gopher is stored on many computers all over the internet called Gopher servers. Now the last one is Waze. Waze is a wide area information service. Now it is an internet search tool that is based on Z39.50 protocol, a standard. This standard describes a protocol for computer-to-computer information retrieval. It works on the client-server principle. A Waze client program enables the user's computer to contact a Waze server, submit a search query and receive a response to that query. So Waze has the capability of simultaneously searching in more than one database. So this is the introduction of introduction to internet. In the next lecture, we will start with the introduction to HTML.